Ambassador Mantagordi, former NEDA Secretary Emmanuel Esguerra, Assistant Secretary Carlo Van Santos, Gael Diaz President Gilbert Canto, my colleagues in government, Philippine government, in Australia. I'm very pleased to see familiar places, faces from Australia, starting from Halley at the Paul, Ashcroft, and many others. Friends, ladies and gentlemen, very good morning. It gives me great pleasure and honor to deliver the keynote address for this conference, participated in by distinguished scholars and serious observers, young and old, of the Philippine economy and politics. This conference sets, arguably, a critical baseline that will shape the thinking and practice of Philippine development policy in the years ahead. I would like to think that I was given the honor to take this role, partly in recognition of my previous role as Socioeconomic Planning Secretary in the Aquino administration, as well as my current role as enforcer and advocate of competition policy and law in the Philippines. Both positions have given me a front row seat to the country's transformation in recent years, the highs and lows of high-level policy making, as well as the transition of power from President Aquino to President Duterte. In keeping with the theme of this conference, let me humbly share some of my own observations and reflections on where the Philippines has been and some lessons learned therefrom, what regulatory and governance challenges need to be addressed moving forward, and how the new administration might navigate the regulatory and governance challenges to sustain economic growth and make it more inclusive. Evidently, the Philippines has enjoyed a surge of growth and macroeconomic stability in recent years. The country's economic growth rate averaged 6.3% from 2010 to 2016, the highest 7-year average growth since the late 1970s. This makes the Philippines one of the fastest growing major emerging economies in Asia and the world today, as pointed out, observed by our ambassador. Such stellar economic performance has also been accompanied by strong macroeconomic fundamentals, high level of confidence among players in the domestic and international business communities, improved competitiveness rankings, and a much stronger external position, owing partly to the resilience of remittances and income from growth areas like business process outsourcing and tourism, notwithstanding the recent development in the global political economy like the Brexit and the Trump's America First populism. Sustaining the growth, and even more importantly, making it more inclusive, that is, translating economic gains into faster reduction of poverty and inequality and access to opportunities, were major challenges for the previous administration and are also likely to be so for the current administration. To be sure, part of the challenge is that globally, economic growth today has become less able to reduce poverty compared to 2 or 3 decades ago. For one, economic growth has become less employment intensive than ever before, partly arising from previous successes in structural transformation of output and employment, and partly from technological developments, especially in automation of production processes. Globalization, facilitated by revolutions in ICT and transport, has also tended to widen the gap between skilled and unskilled segments of the global workforce. In the experience of our neighbors, rapid growth rapid economic growth has resulted in sharp reduction of absolute poverty. In the Philippines, various governance and regulatory practices have weakened the link between growth and poverty reduction. For instance, overtly protectionist food policy kept basic food prices, particularly rice, the staple, much higher than what otherwise would have prevailed if international trade and food was less restricted. Also, across industries, education skill mismatches increased, contributing to the persistently high underemployment rate even among college graduates. Even as public-private partnerships and reforms in budget spending were put in place, various implementation and coordination failures prevented many projects from proceeding at a much faster pace. The new administration has committed to implement reforms toward greater inclusivity, while at the same time continuing and maintaining the previous administration's macroeconomic policies, including fiscal, monetary, and trade policies. For instance, there is a deep-seated commitment to proceed at a more decisive and quicker pace when it comes to implementing projects and programs and addressing bottlenecks, especially those on infrastructure and regulatory processes. In its fiscal program, infrastructure spending as a proportion of GDP is planned to rise from 5.4% in 2017 to 7.3% in 2022. But ensuring poverty reduction and greater inclusivity in the future requires nothing less than acceleration of structural transformation, a shift of employment from low productivity to high productivity sectors, not only across agriculture, industry, and services, but also within each of these sectors. Evidence based on country experiences around the world in the past 50 years indicate that at the heart of the system driving poverty reduction is a structural economic transformation guided by efficiency and innovation promoting policies and institutions. That is certainly the case in the country's neighbors, in China, Vietnam, Thailand, and Indonesia, where structural transformation was key to the dramatic success in reducing poverty in the past three decades. I'm sure Halki will support me on that, otherwise we'll have the third volume of the Philippine economy. The state of competition, let me take note on the state of competition in the Philippine economy. Allow me to point you towards other indicators that might additionally provide a sobering account of our performance with respect to the task of shaping the country's development strategy and competition landscape. Let's be clear, despite some hiccups, the gains that the Philippine economy has made in recent years are nothing to sneeze at. International comparison or country comparisons of economic and business climate point to such significant gains. For instance, in the latest Doing Business report, our country has jumped 49 places in 2017 relative to the country's position in 2010. The 2017 Global Competitiveness Report also placed the country 29 notches higher than its ranking in 2010. However, while we have improved globally, our neighbors have improved even more impressively. In fact, in the 2017 GCR, the Philippines ranks very low among East Asia and Pacific economies. The only countries below our rank are Cambodia, Laos, PDR, and Mongolia. And we place well below the East Asia and Pacific average. In terms of product market efficiency, We are last among the ASEAN member countries or states, excluding Myanmar. This indicator is concerned with conditions of market competition and antitrust policies, aspects of trade, as well as taxes and subsidies. The Philippines ranks 103rd out of 137 countries in this measure, a fact that must not escape policymakers. Based on the World Bank market regulation indicators, which will be presented today by our colleagues from the World Bank, the Philippine markets exhibit higher levels of competition restrictiveness than comparator countries such as Chile, Poland, and Romania. Though the country's product markets appear to be less restrictive than those in major Asian peers such as China, Indonesia, and India, the domestic market in the Philippines is much smaller. Hence, the country's capacity for exploiting specialization and scale economies in the various segments of the supply chain is more limited than among the giants in the region. A number of institutional and governmental bottlenecks have weakened the translation of growth to rapid poverty reduction. In the World Economic Forum's Executive Opinion Survey, released recently, we find that institutional concerns were among the most problematic for our country. These concerns include an inefficient government bureaucracy, corruption, tax regulations, and political instability. Among all ASEAN member states, excluding Myanmar, we rank second to the last under the pillar of institutions, ahead of Cambodia, but far behind Vietnam. We also placed 101st out of 176 in the 2016 Corruption Perception Index. This is a welcome development from our performance in 2010, when we found ourselves ranking 134th out of 178 countries. However, there is obviously much room for improvement. Certainly, institutions are important, and the quality of the prevailing governance regime plays a key role in achieving development outcomes. However, there is a need for policymakers to more clearly define the concept of governance and to press out the mechanism by which good governance can translate into good economics. The theme for the World Development Report 2017 of the World Bank is governance and law. It defines governance as, and I quote, the process through which state and non-state actors interact to design and implement policies within a given set of formal and informal rules that shape and are shaped by power. Governance takes place at different levels, from international bodies to national state institutions to local government agencies to community and business associations, unquote. According to the report, governance is a crucial determinant of how effective a policy will be. The empirical evidence from the literature on growth and cross-country income level difference suggests a comparingly positive association between the quality of institutions and economic growth, as well as GDP per capita levels. In the World Development Report 2017, again, a positive correlation exists between absence of corruption and the level of human development. Similarly, good governance, as indicated by the quality of bureaucracy and rule of law, is correlated with higher levels of per capita income. In the Philippines, different constraints prevent us from enacting and implementing the most optimal kinds of economic policies. As the World Bank report suggests, groups of agents with their own interests will have no incentive to enact such first-best policies. In principle, the pursuit of first-best policies in second markets may actually be welfare-reducing when implemented because they fail to take into account the relevant constraints and power dynamics of society or the existing distortions in other markets. Consideration of these constraints may lead us to choose a second best but feasible policy instead. In 2015, the Philippine Competition Act was signed into law, giving the government an additional policy handle through the Philippine Competition Commission, which I now represent. Competition policy regulates and protects the efficiency of the market, not necessarily that of individual firms. It relies on the market to achieve its goal of efficiency. Since it leaves the work to the market, competition policy economizes on the need for market information. The competition authority only has to concern itself with making sure that anti-competitive practices are not being done. Nevertheless, government regulations exist to address certain circumstances that may, if market forces are left alone, lead to economically inefficient or suboptimal outcomes, the so-called market failures. This can include natural monopolies, public goods, externalities, and asymmetry of information. These market failures may justify the need for some form of government intervention or regulation to ensure efficiency. Of course, the government has other objectives aside from the general goal of increasing efficiency and enduring or inducing economic growth. Equity or social objectives also provide justification for certain public policies. For instance, tax structures and subsidies that favor the poor can help them by increasing their disposable incomes. Coordination failures also create problems in the market, largely due to the presence of asymmetric information. A coordination failure can occur when the provision of a good or service hinges upon the provision of another good or service. Thus, the government can step in to coordinate these investments to produce an optimal outcome where both parties produce goods and services. An example of such a coordination is the creation of special economic zones that provide incentives for the synergy of investments. Regulations are sometimes employed in pursuit of industrial policy objectives. Developing highly productive, globally competitive firms that have linked to many sectors of the economy. Typically, industrial policies are information intensive, and success of such policies is predicated on a strong state capable of proper enforcement. However, it is possible that regulations lead to inferior outcomes if governance is weak. Favorite theme of my colleague, Professor Raul Favella of the City School of Economics. The regulation of industries with economies of scale and tradable products is tempting, as in the case of our country's import substitution phase, as pointed out nearly four decades ago by Romeo Bautista, John Power, and Associates in their pioneering work on industrial promotion policies in the Philippines. But this has led to consequences that are far from what was intended. Through the restrictions of entry of competition, incumbent firms charge higher prices in the domestic market without developing its capacity to export. Some costs and capital were borne by taxpayers, and the lack of market competition only served to increase industrial concentration and underutilized redundant capacity. Unintended consequences can thus arise from well-meaning policies. Put differently, the economic and social consequences of governance failure or government failures can turn out to be worse than those caused by market failures, which government interventions intend to cure or correct. Despite the preceding discussions, however, I would argue that the seeming conflict between competition policy and regulation is largely illusory. Both types of policy instruments are usually not only necessary, but complementary to achieving a development objective. First, the outcome produced by competition policy, which is largely concerned with efficiency, may not coincide with other societal goals. Competition policy has, for example, little to say about equity or distributional goals, or how or of how to value the possible losses by some groups that inevitably arise when resources in an economy are reallocated due to disruptions in the competitive or technological landscape. This is where equity and social policy considerations play a crucial role. The government may enact regulatory policies that can reduce inequality and mitigate the disruption of industry due to effects of competition. Second, competition policy through an independent authority such as the PCC can also complement sectoral regulations by injecting a competition perspective into the formulation or design of regulatory processes and mechanisms. The competition authority can advise the regulator to choose the least anti-competitive means to achieve equity or industrial policy objectives, or to address market failures that impose binding constraints on the economy. This creates a synergistic and mutually beneficial relationship wherein both regulatory agency and competition authority manage to achieve their objectives. Third, while it is often widely thought that the East Asian tigers achieve high growth trajectories and develop global brands through a heavy-handed state that regulated markets, the role of competition policy in the process of structural transformation is often unheralded. In the case of Korea, the government made use of subsidies and protection from trade to build their industrial giants, with expectations that they would deliver on their export targets. However, what made this policy effective is that fierce competition existed and was promoted among domestic firms. Even China, known for its strong state intervention, also implemented a mix of policy, or a mixed policy, by promoting the expansion and limiting of market competition at different time periods to adapt to changing conditions in the Chinese economy. Lastly, even competition authorities recognize the risk and uncertainty prevalent in all kinds of markets. Thus, an economy's governance regime is the context which allows policymakers to decide which type of policy can be used to address specific societal goals. In the event that the institutions governing particular sector are prone to regulatory capture, competition policy may be employed to ensure more optimal outcomes. However, if mechanisms which can enhance transparency, accountability, and competency, or you may call good governance, are instituted, strong regulation can be exploited to achieve societal policy objectives. Both kinds of policies are suitable in achieving a particular objective, contingent on the kind of governance regime that is prevalent among institutions. That's obviously familiar to those who are following Raul Padilla. All in all, the Philippines reform story is far from complete. Presently, there is now deep-seated commitment to proceed at a more decisive and quicker pace when it comes to implementing projects and programs and addressing bottlenecks, especially those on infrastructure and economic governance. Competition policy can work with regulation in addressing equity or social policy objective, or regulations that aid in industrial policy to achieve rapid and inclusive economic growth. The crucial step is to identify the specific policy objective and to understand how the design mechanism achieves this goal. This is important in ensuring that the potential overlaps between different policy objectives and implementing agencies are identified and reconciled. This is also an essential step in the crafting the rules for enforcement. Policymakers must always look for ways by which the same objective can be achieved at a substantially lower cost. Promoting transparency in our institutions not only reduces the risk of occurrence of rent-seeking behavior, but also ensures accountability on the part of the regulators and agencies in delivering the policy objectives. Good governance enables agencies to do their jobs swiftly and efficiently. On this note, the regional and global environment can provide a unique opportunity to act as a check on enforcement and as an exogenous driver of the vicious or virtuous cycle of economic growth and good institutions. Furthermore, partnerships with institutions and our regional neighbors can provide us invaluable assistance in achieving our development objectives. In promoting growth through different regulations or incentives, care must be exercised in order to avoid the creation of white elephants that will only serve to enrich vested interests under the facade of this misguided nationalism. Crafting different programs intended to spur structural transformation must necessitate a careful review of the objectives and enforcement mechanisms of such policies that identify which form of market failure is addressed to lift a binding constraint. Particularly, where these programs involve possible issues of market power or dominance, a competition perspective must be injected to ensure that potential anti-competitive practices are checked and do not become irreversibly entrenched. Ultimately, it is not a question of whether regulation or competition will bring the country closer to its goal of structural change and higher incomes. In a second best world where we recognize numerous constraints on our actions, regulation and competition must be viewed as complementary tools to be used appropriately and in relation to a country's governance regime. Thank you very much.